This is Here's How, Ireland's political, social and current affairs podcast, presented by William Campbell.
Thank you for downloading episode 87 of Here's How for the 2nd of July 2019. I'm sure you've heard about the National Broadband Plan, but just what is planned and why does it cost so much? In this podcast, I'll ask the person responsible.
Here's How is Ireland's political, social and current affairs podcast. Make your view heard. Just dial 076 603 5060 and tell the world what you're thinking. Your voicemail may be included in the next podcast. You can find tips on recording your contribution and other ways to contact the show at hereshow.ie/call.
And that's coming up in full just after this. Does the unit price to the state increase if the take-up is lower than expected? Clearly the total price is capped, but the unit price.
If the actual average cost of the state would obviously increase if over 25 years a lot less people decided to take up the service.
Okay. What is, do you know, the assumption of the percentage take-up that's in the bid?
Well, I think what we've said publicly is that by a certain point in the contract, at least 80% take-up is assumed.
That's coming up in a few minutes, but first I want to thank all the Patreon donors. I appreciate everyone who contributes. In case you don't know, Patreon is basically a system that allows people to donate a buck or two per podcast or per month. That helps me to devote more time to research and to finding interesting guests. And if you think that you could do the same as those people, there's details on the website and at the end of this show. That's audio from an Egyptian news channel called Extra News. It's in Arabic, of course. That clip is 17 seconds long, and it's a news item that, in Arabic, contained 42 words. As I understand it, it was broadcast only once on Extra News, the exact same number of times it was broadcast on all the other Egyptian news channels. And with the exact same text, to the word. And every Egyptian newspaper ran the same story, 42 words long, word for word. The news was about the death of Mohamed Morsi. Morsi was the first and so far the only democratically elected president of Egypt. He won the 2012 elections after the Tahrir Square protests, part of the Arab Spring uprising that swept through the Arab world nearly a decade ago now. The Arab Spring was a protest by a mixture of people, Democrats, liberals, economic reformists and Islamists, who were against the corrupt elites that ruled, in many cases still rule, the Arab countries. The Egyptian army, the real controlling force in the country, saw the way things were going, deposed the long-time dictator, and allowed largely free elections. They didn't go to script. Morsi led the Freedom and Justice Party, an organization affiliated with the Muslim Brotherhood. The party weren't Islamic extremists. They confirmed that they were happy for women and Egypt's minority Christians to serve in government, but they were by no means what people who wanted Egypt to move towards the Western democratic model would have hoped for, although he did seem to be firmly against corruption. He lasted a year. The army, which controls a huge chunk of the Egyptian economy with zero oversight, staged a coup, arrested Morsi, and have imprisoned him ever since, on a whole series of charges. He was on trial last month for those charges when he died, apparently of a heart attack. This is how the Egyptian media announced his death. They all carried an identical 42-word announcement that named him and said he had died and nothing more. They didn't even refer to the fact that he had been president, much less on trial by the military. Every single news outlet waited 3 days, long after the death had been reported internationally, before they ran the story. And they all used the same text, with one exception. This clip from Extra News. Can you hear the familiar word at the end? That's right, the word is Samsung. The extra sentence that this newsreader added on the end translates as sent from a Samsung device, like the default signature on the phone of people who aren't smart enough not to make their every email into an ad for an electronics company. And like TV news stations that aren't smart enough to copy and paste the right text, they get telling them what news to broadcast. Aren't we lucky to live in a democracy where the TV news producers are smarter than that?
Do you agree? Do you disagree? If you want your point of view heard, dial 076-603-5060 and leave a contribution for the show. The lines are open 24/7 and you can find tips on how to record a good contribution and other ways to contact the podcast at hereshow.ie/call.
On the line now, I have Fergal Mulligan. Fergal is the Programme Director at the National Broadband Plan at the Department of Communications. Fergal, the NBP has been getting a lot of publicity. I suspect not all of it pleasing you, but can you just briefly say what exactly is the National Broadband Plan? What's it supposed to do?
Thanks, William. The National Broadband Plan is a government initiative typical of all member states and many countries across the world, where there is a policy objective to ensure that all citizens across every member state has access to high-speed broadband. Those were objectives published by the European Commission in 2011, and the Irish government subscribed to that objective in 2012 when it too published its overall national objective of covering 100% of the country with high-speed broadband. And that then was brought forward into a procurement process after we identified those areas where the commercial sector on its own wouldn't deliver on that policy objective in the medium to long term, absent some state intervention or state subsidy being made available for the rollout of the relevant networks to ensure the availability of high-speed broadband.
And obviously most of the people listening to this are in have internet available to them. And the prices that are being quoted for this, and up to 3 billion euro in order to connect about 500,000 premises, they would be the most difficult to reach 500,000 premises. That sounds like an enormous amount of money. So two questions. One, is it an enormous amount of money for what we're getting? And number two, is it worth it?
Well, it's relatively speaking to a 35-year contract, it wouldn't be an enormous amount of money, but it is a very costly intervention. There's absolutely no doubt about that. We are using state subsidy to do what the commercial sector on its own wouldn't do, and that means it's just not commercially viable for a private operator on its own to cover the entire area that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. Over the last 3 or 4 years, we have been at pains to identify where the state can or should intervene under strict state aid rules. Mm-hmm. And that's left us with 500,000 premises, which are scattered throughout every county and every townland in the country. Mm-hmm. And that's really what made it a very difficult, complex and a very expensive process from the point of view of the state. But ultimately, back to the initial objective, in order to ensure that policy objective of 100% coverage, you really are left with the opposite to the low-hanging fruit, which the commercial sector has taken, but you're left with those premises that just simply are not viable. And as we know, Ireland has a very dispersed population across every county. There's not necessarily a significant rural population, but there's a significant population that may not even be considered rural, but living in areas that are non-commercial. And that's just a factor of the Irish demographic and geographic that's been there for generations and hundreds of years, indeed, and every.
Well, are you sure it's been there? Are you sure it's been there for hundreds of years? Because would I be correct in thinking that the craze in rural Ireland for one-off bungalows in a couple to be built on each farm, which I think a lot of people might suspect is down to local councillors trying to ingratiate themselves with every farmer, allowing them to, you know, make some money for themselves or get a low-cost house for their kids or a bit of both, and building this scattered development, which is not common anywhere else in Europe. I mean, whatever you think about that policy, that policy has certainly caused a large chunk of the problem. That's true, isn't it?
Well, I won't get into public policy of spatial development. It's not my area, but I suppose the facts in front of us are that the significant proportion of the 500,000 homes that we're talking about were not built in the last 10 or 20 years. And that's a fact. There's obviously been a lot of new build in the last 20 years. And yes, those homes have to be addressed with high-speed broadband. You cannot unwind the clock of planning permissions that were issued, I presume, in line with all local authority planning rules, and that's just the nature of the build we have in rural Ireland. I think one of the big things we have in rural Ireland is ribbon.
Fergal, is that a long way of saying yes, they are part of the problem, or they're part of at least the issue?
In every country, that's the issue with getting utility networks out to the far ends of every part of every county, be it in the UK or France or elsewhere. Every country has the same problem because there is people living in every part of every country. And once you have an objective to deliver a service to 100% of those premises, that's where every country has a state subvention required. Indeed, in the UK, they're spending billions as well on access to high-speed broadband, Germany, France, and in Australia, New Zealand.
Okay, I want to get a handle then, Fergal, on the cost that the taxpayer is being hit for, because I've got open here a price comparison website and I'm looking at how much it costs to get broadband in the regular areas, urban and suburban areas, I guess. And I'm looking at the kind of the top five offers, and there's one from Vodafone, 100 megabit service, which is pretty good internet. There's various teaser prices and so forth that you get at €25 a month for the first 6 months and whatever, but it basically ends up at being €45 a month. Then there's a 1 gigabit service that basically ends up at being €55 a month, and you can throw in extra things, but it's basically between €40 and €60 a month. And then I saw an article which RTE actually edited after they published. So it's an article on the RTE website. And the headline on the RTE website was originally €12,000 per house in order to connect the broadband. And I want to understand that cost. Is that the cost that the taxpayer is paying, or is the householder paying some of that cost, or what's the mix there?
Okay, well, first of all, the headline figure of 12,000 is not correct. What's been used in the public domain is 4,000 to 5,000 per premise, maybe the public subsidy required to connect each premises over the next 25 years. And that is based on the following numbers. The number of 3 billion, again, is an up to number of, it's actually 2.9 billion, and that includes 355 million of VAT, which doesn't leave the government. It goes from this department over to the Revenue Commissioner. So in net terms, what we're saying is the overall maximum cost of this project could be 2.6 billion.
Mm-hmm.
And that 2.6 billion also includes 480 million of a contingency.
Pause on that thought for a moment, Fergal. Yep. Are you aware of any multi-billion infrastructure plan in Ireland that came in under budget?
I am not fully aware of other the only obvious one that you're talking about probably is the hospital, which is not a comparable project in the context of what way that has gone through its process.
But be it Port Tunnels or Lewis or whatever, they have a distinct tendency to increase in price during the project. I'm not aware of any that came in significantly under budget.
I think you'll find the majority of roads in the last number of years have all come in under budget, and I think that's been widely reported by Transport Infrastructure Ireland and other authorities involved in the roads network. Again, once the initial projects many years ago were possibly over budget, but lessons were learned. One thing I would say about the National Broadband Project is we have been involved in this since 2014. Mm-hmm. We have gone through 3 to 4 years of rigorous engagement with the industry through what they call a competitive dialogue process, where we had all the main players in the market, Vodafone, ESB, Aircom, and the current bidder and others at the table. who provided all their necessary input to what they think it would cost based on their own actual experience. So we are going into this process with a much greater degree of confidence of being within an overall total of a maximum cost of the state of $2.6 billion. Mm-hmm. And we expect that to be no more than $1.8 in the first 10 years, $1.8 billion, and with money to be spent thereafter because houses will continue to be connected. But also a significant cost of this is renting or leasing infrastructure from third parties such as Aircom and Enet. So we will be spending up to €1 billion in renting third-party infrastructure, which is a key determinant of the overall cost. So unlike other projects or infrastructures, we have an existing infrastructure in place across the country. We actually have two. We have the air pole and duct infrastructure, and we have the ESB pole and duct infrastructure. Now, the winning bidder, the preferred bidder, has selected the air infrastructure, and it is going to use about 1.5 million poles that have been there for the last 40, 50 years, but most of which have been upgraded over after 25, 30 years, they're replaced. And that's an iterative process that AIR does and will continue to do for the next 25 years.
And the long and the short of it is that the broadband contractor will essentially rent slots on the AIR poles. That's essentially what you're saying.
A key requirement when we set out in this process was for bidders to give us the most cost-effective and efficient design of a network that would deliver the objective of getting high-speed broadband. So we didn't set out the solution. We asked people to, in the bid process, say, tell us how we ensure high-speed broadband is delivered to all premises in these areas and will stand the test of time in terms of demand and the demands of networks over the next 25, 30 years when the actual throughput in these networks is growing exponentially. And what I mean by that is we've all seen the explosion of data being used on these networks, be it mobile or fixed networks, due to applications coming on stream from the likes of Apple and Google and Amazon and all these other...
Watching Netflix burns up more data than sending an email.
All of those things are uploading, an architect uploading a file or a pharmacy.
I understand that, but I want to, because what I think is very important to be clear on the price, and you're saying that $3 billion is at the very top end, including contingencies. That's fair enough. But $3 billion divided by $500,000 is €6,000 per premises. That's what the taxpayer is shelling out. Am I correct on that?
That is the requirement from the taxpayer.
Okay.
On top of that,
the householder isn't getting it for free. They're paying money on top of that, yeah?
Yeah, so let me explain how the model works, the business model for this works. Mm-hmm. The householder will get a connection to this network for €100, regardless of the cost of that connection.
Okay.
So effectively, you're subsidizing the fiber to be built on the Aircom pole and duct network from the local village or local town to your home, and you will pay no more than €100 to get connected. Now, thereafter, you will pay the normal price that you would pay if you're in Dublin. So if that's €40 or €50. Again, our network will be an open access wholesale network, and that's a really important point, that this network, once it's built, consumers in rural areas will be able to avail of the multitudes of retail service providers, such as the Virgin Media, such as the Sky, such as the Aircom.
Pause there, because I want to make sure people understand that. So they'll be a wholesaler, a little bit like AIR, and they then won't actually sell the product to the customer directly. You'll have multiple of ads. Virgin will say, we'll connect you for X price. Vodafone maybe will say, we'll connect you for a different price with a different packet, and you get these channels and so forth.
William, everybody will be connected on the same terms and conditions. But where the competition will come in is at the service level. So consumers will get multiple offers of packages, be it TV, broadband, fixed voice, security service, whatever can be done over this network, and that includes everything. Once it's a fiber network, these service providers can offer loads and loads of value-add services. Obviously, the anchor product is the high-speed broadband product, and consumers will then have a plethora of operators and retailers that they can buy from. But those retailers will all buy from the National Broadband Ireland network, which is the wholesale access network. And where the competition will come in is similar to what you have with the Energy Ireland and Electric Ireland and SSE Energy. You will be able to select the most attractive tariff plan to you for, a two-year contract. So if you want to pay €40 a month for a basic service sort of plan, or 80 euros for a plan that includes many other services such as TV or sports, etc. Mm-hmm. Those plans will be made available over this platform, and that's what will continue to be made available for 20 years. So consumers will see a massive benefit of choice, a choice of service that they can purchase. So today...
That's understood, Fargon. People know those different options.
Okay.
And as you say, it's a little bit like the electricity. Everybody gets the one wire coming into their house, but they can now buy their electricity from a multiple of different suppliers, and they might, you know, prefer to get a higher mix of wind energy or whatever.
Yeah.
But there's one part of the maths that I can't see how you're correct on, and maybe you can explain that to me. So the 3 billion up to divided by 500,000 is 6,000 per premises. What happens if not all of those 500,000 premises sign up? If they say, internet, not interested. Do you then claw back 6,000 or whatever per premises that chooses not to get connected? Or is that a fixed price for the total project? And then if the penetration is less than 100%, the cost per connecting household is higher? Which of those is the case?
Okay, so I'm just going to make 2 points. The first point I'm going to pick up on, which is an important one. The 3 billion includes 355 million of VAT, which is a circular charge within the government.
Come on. You're a civil servant. You get paid your salary. The salary that's quoted is your gross salary. The fact that you pay your tax to your employer, it's an accounting trick to say that it doesn't cost that.
My main point there, William, is though we are not paying 355 million out to the bidder. So the cost that we're actually paying out to this private company is 2.1 billion committed up to 25 years, plus a contingency fund of 480 million. That's 2.6 million will be
billion.
In public funds that will be paid out to this private operator. That's the important point I'm trying to make.
I understand that. Okay. But if you weren't buying that, if the government wasn't buying that, they'd be buying something else and being paid VAT on that. So it's not, I'm sure you're intelligent enough to know that it's not magic money.
If you want to look at opportunity costs and different things like that, I'm sure it comes into the equation somewhere along the way.
But then address, address the point. If you get less than 100% penetration, does the price come down or does the cost per connection increase as the number of connections decreases?
The final price is based on a final tender. So the price cannot go up from the final bid price. So,
and which price? The total price or the price per unit?
The total price of the overall gross cost, which we're talking about here, I call 2.6 billion, you call 2.9, is the cost of the state of this project, regardless of the number of connections potentially.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do we protect the state from overpaying? And that's the key point that I think you're making.
Yes.
We pay this in stages. We pay, first of all, to design the network. We pay to pass the network. And passing is when you forget about connections, but you still have to. If there's 10 homes in the road and only 5 homes want it or 10 homes want it, you still have to pass all premises with fibre down the road from, say, it's a 3-mile road. The full road needs to be covered with fibre on those poles.
Mm-hmm.
And we will pay milestones based on that. And as I said last week in another, in the Oireachtas committee, the overall cost of passing premises is in the order of 1 billion euros. Okay, so that's what you will be paying out to pass all the premises. There's another budget of 400 to 700 million that we have included in the final bid to connect premises. And that is only paid out as premises connect. So back to, as you say, if half the people decide that they want to get connected, well, then we only pay for the connections that are actually made.
Okay, so pause there. I want to get that maths. So you've got something in the region of, maybe I'm getting the ratio not quite correct, but you've got something in the region of 2/3 of the cost is the cost to run the wire down the road, and then 1/3 of the cost is the cost to connect each house. So when some of the houses say, we're not interested in that at all, you get a clawback on 1/3 of the cost, the connection cost, but you don't get a clawback on the cost of running the wire down the road. Is that, roughly speaking, correct?
No, it's not. Again, because it's a bid model, the bid model is based on everyone's best estimate, including all the bidders that were at the table, of how much it would cost to run that fibre down the road. For example, what's the cost of that fibre on the market? We made the bidder made its best estimate, as did other bidders, on what's the likely cost of fibre over the next 7 years, which you would go to the market with every year through a procurement process, and you buy fibre on the market like any commodity, and the prices go up and down.
Mm-hmm.
If the price of the commodity of fibre goes down, which it could do because it's becoming far more demand and supply, then if the price comes down, we claw back 100% of the savings that the bidder may save over the next 7 years. So if there's an estimate of cost of fibre of X and it turns out to be Y, say 20% less, we only pay the actual cost. There is a significant clawback on the cost of building the network in the first place.
That's a different topic, and I appreciate that, and that's important. So that essentially if the bidder is exposed to lower costs, they can't just pocket that. They essentially have to return that money to the state. I find that a little bit dangerous because, of course, that doesn't then motivate them to get the best value. But I'll come on to that in a moment. I want to fix on this until I get an idea. Roughly speaking, the ratio, you mentioned it, you called it the passing cost, what it costs to run the wire down the road, and the connection cost, what it costs to connect each household. Is that somewhere in the region of 2/3 is the passing cost, 1/3 is the connection cost? It's in that range.
Again, it's slightly complicated by the leasing of the infrastructure from Aircom, because in those numbers I just quoted you, that did not include renting the poles and renting the ducts from Aircom.
Okay.
So that, again, the overall cost of this is the overall cost of the project, and that's where the $5 billion has been talked about also by us in the public domain.
Yeah.
Some people are confusing the cost of the project, which is what you're trying to establish there, versus the cost of the state.
Yeah, so the cost of the project would include the cost paid by the consumer.
The cost of the project includes the cost of passing the wire down the road, the cost of connecting consumers, the cost of leasing the infrastructure for 25 years, and then the cost of operating the network for 25 years.
Yeah.
And that's the overall cost of the project.
To maybe bring it down to brass tacks, because I really have read very widely on this and haven't been able to get an answer. If there's 100 houses on a road and the last guy wants the connection, so the wire has to go all the way down to the end of the road.
Yeah.
If one guy on the road wants a connection, if 20, 50 or 100% of them want a connection, that changes the cost to the state. I'm thinking to the state here. So the cost to the state. Does that change the cost to the state?
It could do, absolutely.
Okay.
Because you could be saving a significant amount of cost.
Uh-huh.
And if you do save a significant amount of cost, as I said, we do claw back any, well, first of all, we wouldn't have paid the bidder to build that network. And on a case-by-case basis...
No, wait. The last guy on the road wants it.
Yeah.
So you need to run it to the end of the road. But does the cost to the state increase...
Oh, sorry, it won't increase. No, it cannot increase because...
Is the cost to the state different if one of the 100 guys on the road or 50 or 100 of them want a connection?
Yeah. I think the net point you're trying to make is the cost to the state cannot increase. It could reduce. It cannot increase because if the demand down that road is different to what the bidder has assumed in its bid, well, then the bidder bears the risk of that being a lower take-up and therefore its unit cost increases.
Mm-hmm.
And that sits with the private sector in this bid. Now, obviously, the bidder has carried out its own market research, it's carried out its own analysis, and within its bid, it's put in place a demand model that it's confident it will deliver on. And don't forget, it's a 25-year plan.
Mm-hmm.
So they have made assumptions of what will the take-up on that road be in year 1 to 10, and from year 10 to 25.
Okay, that's fine.
But ultimately, the risk sits with them.
I understand what you're saying, that the risk sits with them. But my question is, would the unit cost to the state change significantly depending on the take-up?
Well, again, if in 10 years' time, we would say we assumed 400,000 or 500,000 people would take this service or would look at it over a longer period of time.
Yeah.
And if that take-up was, say, 50% less than was expected, well, then at certain points along the road, you wouldn't be waiting till year 10 or 12 to find that out. You would find that out in year 2, 4, 6. And at that point, decisions would have to be made as to whether or not the project was sustainable.
Okay, but my question there then is very,
because
very precise, and you've helped me hone the question. So the question is, does the unit price to the state, unit per connection, does the unit price to the state increase if the take-up is lower than expected?
If you're
clearly the total price is capped, but the unit price.
If the actual average cost of the state would obviously increase if over 25 years a lot less people decided to take up the service.
Okay. What is, do you know, the assumption of the percentage take-up that's in the bid?
Well, I think what we've said publicly is that by a certain point in the contract, at least 80% take-up is assumed.
Okay, okay. So that's 400,000 out of 500,000. I want to look at some records of the Committee on Public Accounts that AIR spoke to. Caroline Lennon of AIR spoke to them, and she said that there was a separate project. So if you look at this project, the NBP project, that's the most difficult to reach 500,000. If we talk about low-hanging fruit, that's the highest hanging fruit.
Yeah, exactly.
AIR did a project on the next highest hanging fruit. So not the most difficult 500,000, but the next most difficult 300,000, not included in the 500,000.
Yeah.
And they're trying to get wired into every settlement in Ireland that has 1,000 premises or more. That's basically where they're going at. This is what Caroline Lennon said. She said, we're very happy with the uptake. The last figure we published was 14% uptake, but that was some time ago. For homes that were passed at the start of the build, penetration is more than double that figure. So that's something like 30% take up. Now, that's clearly way lower than your 80%. She is obviously projecting the best that she can of AIR, and she's talking about homes that were passed at the very start of the build, so they've had the longest time to take that up. But would you agree with me that the character of homes in very rural and very isolated areas and the character of the people who live there is significantly different, and that demand for internet correlates negatively with remoteness? That's to say, the further out people are, the less they want internet, perhaps because of an age profile, or perhaps because they've deliberately moved out of towns to be away from technology and so forth, that they don't want it. And if AIR are getting something between 14 and 30% in much less isolated areas than you're going for, doesn't 80% seem wildly optimistic?
Well, in a simple answer, no, it doesn't. And I think that the history of telecoms would show that in terms of the take-up of the telephone service or the take-up of broadband to date. Aircom have, over the last 4 or 5 years, upgraded all their old broadband technology, what they used to call ADSL, to VDSL, and more recently to fibre to the home. And the exact same trends follow as the networks are built. And you will find, and it's all available on Comreg's website, that there's been a significant uptake of high-speed broadband where it's available. The difference between...
Yeah, but that's the point. Hold the point. There's a significant uptake where it's available because the communications companies do market research and they say, okay, where's the real demand? They build it there and they get significant uptake. They didn't build it where it isn't built because they know something about the level of uptake that's likely.
Well, I think what you'll find is, and that's what comes through the bid process, is it's not down to the likely market demand. It's down to the actual cost and the whether you can make something that is a very high cost, capital cost, commercial for shareholders. And the answer to all that was no, because simply the average cost is far outweighs the likely average revenue you get over the next 10 years or so. And very few investors these days look into a 25, 35 year horizon, which is what the National Broadband Plan does. So to answer your question, though, it would suggest that there's a significant divergence between the AIRCOM 300,000 fibre to home, which is on the same roads going at every village in rural Ireland, versus what's left on those roads. And there's no research to suggest that any given family or any given home along all those are different in characteristic. Every part of rural Ireland has a demographic profile of older people living in them, but a lot of younger families coming in also, and younger families don't choose the first 2 miles of the road or versus the last 2 miles of the road for any
particular
reason.
You're saying that every area of Ireland has the same demographic profile?
I'm not going to say the same, because I'm sure there's variances. Of course there's variances.
There's huge variances.
But let me go back to your original point about the 14% and 30%.
Yeah.
Because what that misunderstands is the business model of all telecom operators. And the business model for fibre to home or fibre to cabinet, which is the predecessor to that, is the time. The time that it takes to get your mass market There's obviously first mover advantage for many consumers that get on any network, but it takes time for people to actually migrate to the high-speed broadband networks. And then also consumer behavior changes with the applications that are made available and being sold over these networks. And again, consumer behavior, and this is why, you know, I was making the point earlier about the wholesale open access nature of National Broadband Ireland, mm-hmm. is there's nothing to suggest that families in rural Ireland that have a high-speed broadband network available where they can buy a bundle of television, broadband, landlines, mobile services, there's no research to suggest that there's any different demand profile of those consumers versus their nearing neighbours.
Okay.
That if the network is there that makes a product available for 40, 50 or 60 euros, that they would decide not to purchase that service. The thing about the National Broadband Ireland network build, it's a 7-year build. Mm-hmm. The thing about the Aircom 300K build was it's a 2 to 3, 4 year build. And it takes a long time to connect consumers. For example, with the Aircom figures that were being quoted, at those times that Aircom quoted 14%, neither Sky or Vodafone were selling any retail services.
Okay, I want to move on then a little bit because, and I looked at the price comparison website, there is, you know, you're paying roughly, for broadband only, you're paying roughly 40 to 60 quid a month. Of course, that's including 23% VAT. So, yeah. You know, you're paying tax on that and we don't get the VAT back, unlike the government. It doesn't come back to the person who's paying it. But I just want to look at fairness on that because people who live in urban Ireland and people who live in rural Ireland benefit from different types of services and pay differently for them. And for example, people who live in urban Ireland pay vastly more, typically, for the houses they live in. They typically have very tough commutes in the sense that they endure a large amount of traffic congestion. And there's a whole slew of other amenities that cost more and less depending on where you live. And you could argue that people in rural Ireland have the amenity of rural Ireland right there with them. And very often that's why people move to rural Ireland and they make that choice. And that choice for sure has some costs and it has some benefits. Nobody ever suggested that people living in urban Ireland should have all of the costs of living in urban Ireland subsidised by the people who live in rural areas. Why should this cost of people who live in rural areas be subsidised by urban dwellers?
Well, I suppose in 2015, we ran a very significant public consultation around the intervention strategy that underpinned the procurement process and underpinned the policy objectives of this process. And from the get-go in 2015, the policy objective has been to ensure 100% access to high-speed broadband. And in 2015, it was decided that access should be at the same or similar comparable prices to what's available in urban areas.
Dwellers should be stuck with the cost.
But I mean, that happens across many different things in public life, in terms of public policy, that there's cross-subsidization across all areas.
Yeah, lots of unfairness, you know, doesn't justify more unfairness, does it?
Well, I suppose you have to look at the benefits of the National Broadband Plan. So I'll just move on to that. I mean, there's obviously significant benefits if more people working in towns and cities can remote work. And mm-hmm. that's a significant advantage of building a high-speed broadband network. And that will hopefully decongest some of our roads. And obviously, you know, allow people to remain living in rural Ireland. Not necessarily moving people from urban to rural, but it's really important that the people that live in rural Ireland today continue to live there and have an opportunity to live there, and are not travelling, you know, long distances to get to towns and villages where they could work from home. And there's many entrepreneurs and many small businesses that would prefer to work at home in their local house or village. And again, to facilitate local businesses, we're rolling out to 300 broadband connection points in the first year of this network build as well, to allow local community centres and GA halls and different public buildings maybe that are not currently used to their maximum potential, but giving them the access to that gigabit connectivity that will allow the sort of spread of the workload across the country, where we know the East Coast is very congested and our motorways are very congested. And we believe this network will help remove some of that problem that we see in urban areas. And that will help everybody across the country.
Okay, one last question. The state is putting in something like 2.6 to 2.9 billion, depending on how you count it. There were reports that the successful bidder is putting in something in the region of 200 million euro. Am I correct on that?
I think what the Taoiseach and other our ministers said publicly is the amount of equity that's going in is 175 million with the working capital facility of another 45, I think is what, up to 220 million. So 220 million is the amount of money that's been committed by the private sector.
Okay, okay. That's the contractor is putting in 10%. The state is putting in 90%. At the end of the process, what's the ownership split?
Yeah, so again, as explained, there's an initial requirement of 220 million, but back to your question about who takes the risk on demand.
Who takes the ownership at the end?
At the end of 25 years, there's a commitment to continue with the contract to operate without a subsidy up to year 35. In the event that the bidder doesn't commit to the extra 10 years, the state has the option to take back the business or the network.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of 25 years, the winning bidder and the private owner, subject to these conditions and many, many conditions, will own the network, which is essentially a fibre cable along a leased infrastructure from Aircom.
That's a hell of a deal.
It's a hell of a deal to the state if they successfully cover the entire intervention area with high-speed broadband and keep that network going for 35 years. And that, as we say, we get that 80% take-up to reap the benefits of remote working and all the other benefits that we want to see in terms of public policy.
Maybe Fergal, education, healthcare
and everything else, you know.
Maybe Fergal, at the end of that 35 years, we'll all be able to go to work in our flying cars. Fergal Mulligan, Programme Director at the National Broadband Plan for the Department of Communications. Thank you very much for talking to me.
Thanks, William. Bye-bye.
Make your view heard. Record your own contribution and email it to podcast@hereshow.ie. You can find tips on how to record a good contribution and other ways to contact the podcast at hereshow.ie/call.
If you'd like to hear more podcasts from me, I'd certainly love to do them, and I could devote more time to them if I got them sponsored. I have a page on Patreon that allows ordinary listeners to donate a dollar or two per podcast or per month, whatever you want. So if you think that it's valuable, please do that and share the podcast with your friends so they can do the same. Go to the website for sources and references from the show. And while you're there, you can like the show on Facebook, follow @HeresHowPodcast on Twitter, and get in touch with me if you can suggest a guest or a topic for a future show. Also, you can find out how to subscribe to the podcast for free on your computer, on your phone, or by email. All that, including my Patreon link, are at www.hereshow.ie. The Here's How podcast is produced and presented by me, William Campbell. Thank you for listening.